Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 32nd meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind all those members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business is an evidence session with the Minister for Environment and Land Reform on the Hunting with Dogs Bill Scotland, and we have 1 hour scheduled for this session. And a welcome to the meeting, Mary McCallan, the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, Hugh Dignan, Head of Wildlife and Flood Management Unit, Leah Fitzgerald, the Bill Team Leader, and Amy Hogarth, the Solicitor. Can I invite the Minister to make an opening statement?
Of course. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone, and thank you for having me. I'm very pleased to be able to come today to discuss the interplay between the Bill and the activities which are often collectively described as rough shooting. I want to begin my comments... I'd like to begin with a comment on the inclusion of rough shooting within the Bill, and by correcting any suggestion that rough shooting was overlooked or not considered by the Scottish Government. The Bill is ultimately about regulating the use of dogs to hunt wild mammals in the countryside, and it applies across the piece to those who would use dogs in the course of hunting. And in fact, it's a strength of the Bill that it doesn't differentiate between the types of hunting which are permitted under exception, and instead puts out the conditions under which dogs would need to be used in the course of hunting. So rough shooting and related types of hunting have always been part of the Bill. Indeed, that's why, since publication, the Bill has had an exception for game shooting. Now, having mentioned that, I'd like to move on to address the issue of clarity. Of course, in his evidence session, Lord Bonamy remarked that the Bill was a very well-crafted piece of legislation, making everything clearer and simpler. However, I absolutely recognise that some seek further clarity on exactly how the Bill interacts with rough shooting, and I'll try to add to the already considerable and helpful evidence that you've taken in that regard today. And I'd like to say that, of course, I am, as ever, open to suggestions as to how matters could be strengthened where any member feels that's required. But in the time I had left, allow me to set out my position on the interplay, starting with what constitutes an activity under the Bill. I know this is something that has been discussed. So a person is undertaking an activity under the Bill if they are using a dog to search for, stalk or flush a wild mammal from cover as part of an exception to the general rule against hunting with dogs. And in the case of rough shooting, this would be under Section 6, entitled Falconry Game Shooting and Deer Stalking. Now, the effect of Section 6 is that an individual can undertake an activity with up to, two dogs. The provisions do not prevent multiple people undertaking separate activities in the same location, but it does set out clearly how they must conduct themselves when undertaking that activity. And these conditions, as well as the two-dog limit, are taking reasonable steps to ensure the dog doesn't join with another to form a pack of more than two, that any dog used is under control, that you have landowner's permission, etc. All of this applies, as with other types of hunting, to ensure that dogs do not form packs, do not chase and kill wild mammals. Now, you've heard much evidence that breeds generally used in rough shooting, they do not form packs, they will not chase animals, they are well trained, they are under control, and interestingly wouldn't return to a rough shoot if they breached any of that. I have heard this clearly at your evidence sessions, and this gives me confidence that rough shoots should have no difficulty in complying with the law. Indeed, while some adjustment may be required, many already practice what will be required under the Bill. Now, I know a lot of this was discussed at your roundtable event, and there was understanding among many about what the regulation of the Bill meant for rough shooting in practice. However, I know that some of those at the roundtable last week, when you got through what I thought was a really helpful session, you got to the nub of the issue being the vexatious complaints and the risk of that. This, of course, is something that I wouldn't want to see happen. I'm happy to work with shooting organisations to produce guidance to make sure that was available to anyone with an interest. But alongside that, you equally had some very helpful evidence from Police Scotland about their role in evidence gathering. And I believe that Detective Sergeant Telfer mentioned that they would, for claims, vexatious or otherwise, consider the breed of dog, the distance between the dogs, what reasonable steps had been taken to separate any who had joined up. He said they would discuss with witnesses, they would consult experts, and they may seize phones. Ultimately, I believe that the risk of ill-intentioned or vexatious claims about the conduct of rough shoots can be managed, including via the good relationship which was discussed at your roundtable between the shooting industry and the police. And the risk of vexatious claims does not, in my view, justify acting in a way that could undermine the bill by opening up a loophole to those who would seek to exploit it. And actually, I'm sure that the rough shooting community shouldn't want to be embroiled in that either. So, in conclusion, I have set out that consistent intent of the bill, how it practically applies to most of what I found to be termed rough shooting, and how I believe that any vexatious claims could be managed and do not justify creating a loophole in the legislation. Having said that, we are not yet at stage two, and I remain happy to consider whether there's anything that I can do within the bill to clarify my position, and indeed I will consider all amendments ahead of stage two. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. What I want to kick off with is looking at the balance of impact on people who currently undertake legal shooting activities, and to make sure that there's clarity around enforcement of when there's illegal activities, and that the animal welfare objectives of the bill, as we all know, is a primary reason or objective for the bill, to make sure those are met. But the committee's not aware, and certainly I'm not aware of any evidence that rabbits have ever, the welfare of rabbits has ever been a consideration. Yet we understand that rabbits are included as part of the way to ensure that hair coursing stopped, make it easier for hair coursing to stop. But since rabbit welfare has never been raised within the bill or prior to the bill, or evidence of animal welfare, why couldn't we include a reckless element in the legislation along with landowners' permission to ensure that would satisfy the level of evidence for a conviction against hair coursing? And we also heard that from DC Telford that those elements would greatly assist, and also when it came to poaching. The refusal, if you like, not to have an exclusion for rough shooting, which you've said can be clearly identified, why is there not an exclusion for that, and to get rid of some of these unintended consequences?
Thanks, Convener. Thank you for the question. There are a number of aspects there, but you'll have to forgive me. I'm going to have to unpack in turn, but I'll try and be as quick as possible. So you mentioned, first of all, the inclusion of rabbits, the issue of the welfare of rabbits and evidence in that regard. So, first of all, I have been clear since the introduction of this bill that the inclusion of rabbits within it was, the purpose of that was twofold. One was about the welfare of rabbits, and the other was about avoiding the taking of rabbits being used as a cover for hair coursing. And on welfare, well, in terms of evidence, I know that Mike Flynn said to us, and I quote, "A lot of people think that in all these sorts of activities, the dogs kill the animals instantly. You might get away with that with mice or rats, but it's definitely not the case with foxes or rabbits. Not all of them are killed instantly, and in any case, they also experience the fear of being chased." So that goes to the heart of the fact that a rabbit is a sentient being, and we ought to treat, if we protect hares, we ought to treat it similarly. And I know that Kirsty Jenkins of One Kind made that point at your roundtable last week. And of course, the second reason that we included rabbits was to make sure that it couldn't no longer be used as a cover for hair coursing. And on that note, I know that Rachel Hamilton at your round table asked the police DS Telford about that. And he said, and I quote, "I certainly think that in relation to the enforcement of hair coursing offences, the addition of rabbits would aid police investigation." Rachel Hamilton then asked, "Is that evidence-based?" DS Telford said, "Yes." So that's my position. Equally, I would say that removing rabbits from the scope of the bill would not take rough shooting out with the remit of it, because it would remain that animals such as foxes and hares would be shot in this way and they would still be under the bill. The second part that you mentioned about the suggestion of a reckless element and landowner permission, I know that this was something that the Scottish Countryside Alliance have mentioned. It's something I've considered, and as I've said, I keep considering this. I'm not going to stand in the way of making this bill better. I want to see it. I want to see it succeed. But, however, two points to that. Firstly, words like recklessness, words like deliberately, these were the exact terms that Lord Bonamy advised us should be removed or not contained in the new Act in order to avoid a subjectivity which is not helpful. And the other point I would make is that landowner permission is already required under the bill. And of course, it doesn't address the welfare element.
Okay. Can we go, given that we're looking at rough shooting specifically, and if your understanding of rough shooting is correct, do you know of any circumstances where a dog would chase a rabbit and kill a rabbit?
Do I know of any circumstances where that's happened, or could I envisage that that
could happen? You quoted Mike Flynn about dogs chasing rabbits or catching and killing them, and it's not and inferred that it wasn't instant. But with rough shooting, are you aware of that ever happening? Is the evidence that we've heard not suggest that that absolutely doesn't happen, that rabbits aren't chased and they absolutely aren't caught and killed by dogs?
I've certainly heard a great deal of evidence about the behaviour of gun dogs, their control, how well trained they are, which gives me confidence that they'll be able to comply with the need not to do that. Whether I can envisage a scenario where it could happen, of course it could happen. And I think, you know, Mike Flynn, with decades of experience in the SSPCA, has given evidence to this committee that it can happen.
But I think Mike said he thinks he didn't say there was any evidence that dogs regarding rough shooting were chasing or catching and killing dogs. And we're looking specifically at rough shooting. And if it's so clearly defined, why is there not an exemption? That's the point I'm driving at.
I think my colleague Hugh wants to come in, and then I can come back to you.
I think it's fair to say that Mike Flynn is specifically talking about the sort of coursing of hares and rabbits and that sort of thing. However, as the Minister has pointed out, that if we take rabbits out of the bill, it then creates a much wider loophole that has the potential to be exploited by anybody who would like to use more than two dogs and claim they were in pursuit of rabbits, which would be a clear loophole for those who had sort of another agenda to pursue. So I think there's sort of two separate elements to that. There is clearly an ongoing welfare concern about rabbits and coursing, but there is also a need for consistency through the bill to ensure that rabbits are not excluded from the bill and thereby creating a loophole for those who'd want to exploit that.
So do you believe rough shooting could ever be confused with hare coursing or traditional fox hunting?
Well, Hume, you might want to come back on that as well, but what I believe is that I am bringing forward a bill which seeks to regulate across the piece the way that dogs are used in the course of hunting in the countryside, and consistency in that regard is important.
Okay. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. I'd like to pick up on a point that Chief Superintendent Mike Flynn made last week. He questioned why rough shooting should be given special treatment by being allowed to use more dogs than what he termed for essential pest control. And I heard your opening statement, but I just want to ask the question. I understand your need to balance the right of people to conduct legal shooting activities against animal welfare, but how would widening the exception for rough shooting, a form of hunting for sport, be compatible with the government's stated purpose of achieving the highest possible standards of animal welfare?
Yeah, I think, thank you, Ariane Burgess, for the question. And I heard Mike Flynn make that point the other day. I think it's a reasonable point among many points as to why we shouldn't create an exemption here. As Hugh said, we risk creating a glaring loophole in the bill. Mike Flynn's point about the consistency and the fact that it would be imbalanced and disproportionate to have a situation where there were greater restrictions on those seeking to protect their livestock from predation than those who pursued sports. Now, that's not me making a comment about people pursuing sports and the reason for doing that. This is about me saying, I want a bill that applies consistently across the piece, and that's the only way to do this properly. The other point, of course, is that if we're talking about the risk of creating a loophole, I believe that the shooting industry and the folks that you had round your roundtable do not want to find themselves at the other side of this bill, if they were taken out with the scope of it, being part of the cover for illegal hunting moving forward. They are law-abiding people who are undertaking an activity in the countryside. I'm asking them to make minimal adaptations in order to comply with this, and it will mean that in the aftermath of the bill, they do not find themselves besmirched by any attempts to circumvent the law.
Thank you.
I'm going to bring in Rachel Hamilton. I think she wanted to respond.
Yeah, I just wanted to know what evidence the Scottish Government have that rough shooting is connected to welfare issues for rabbits.
I can come back to you on that. You know, I point again to what D.S. Telford said in your exchange. You asked him if it was based on evidence's view. He said yes. I'm pointing to comments including that from Mike Flynn and indeed from Kirsty Jenkins of One Kind when she said rabbits are sentient beings who are capable of suffering the same panic when they're chased and the same pain when they're killed. Now, I believe that we should treat them on a similar terms to here, but I can come back to Rachel Hamilton with written response on that if she wishes.
Thank you very much.
Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister.
Morning.
You mentioned just earlier that the fear of being chased is part of the animal welfare concern, and I understand that the aim of the bill is to balance animal welfare with wildlife control. So why is there this exception for hunting with dogs within Section 6 where the primary purpose is sporting rather than wildlife control? How does that meet that balance?
What I would say in response to that is that these are legal activities in Scotland. Rough shooting is a legal activity. Falconry is a legal activity. And in the course of, you know, pursuing what the government is trying to with this bill, I'm not in the business of trying to, by the back door, close down activities which are otherwise legal. That's not the purpose of this bill, and it would be an arbitrary stretch of the bill if we were to do that. And I need to try and make sure that we avoid doing that.
Jim, did you?
Minister, last week, I think it was Robbie Marsland made the point that the purpose of this not being an exemption isn't about what's happening just now and the very legal way that shoots will conduct themselves. It's about who may then try to tag on to that or call it a rough shoot. I have to say that during the evidence session, I became more and more comfortable with the way the bill was running on that basis. It's not about what's happening now. As you've just said, the people who are conducting shoots at the moment do it in a very effective legal manner. It's what happens when people start to use it after the bill is implemented. Would that be your concern as well?
Yes, I think it's part of the concern. You know, first and foremost, my job is to regulate the way that dogs are used in the course of hunting in the countryside. But it is certainly a consideration that consistency with that is important to avoid the loopholes of the future. And I've tried to say that from the beginning. This work is about closing the loopholes of the 2002 Act and making sure that more don't open up. And we want to make sure that that's the case so that unlawful hunting in Scotland finally ends. But equally, there is clearly an interest of the shooting industry not to get into a situation where their perfectly legal activity at the other side of this is found to be the guise under which unlawful hunting is tried to be pursued.
Thank you, Convener.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I want to ask, in regards to the roundtable last week, I thought it was extremely helpful as well, and I was satisfied by their comments in regards to how well the hunts were run, how seriously they really took the safety of everyone involved, and how in particular they had trained the dogs exceptionally well. And it really came down to, I think, what you mentioned in your opening statements, that the real concern was the vexatious complaints that may happen and disrupt hunts if there's to be investigations at that time. I asked DC Telford if he thought forewarning would be helpful for the police to know that these rough shoots were going to be happening, and he said it would. And I was just wondering what your thoughts are on that.
Thank you, Ms. Adam, for the question. I observed that part of the discussion. I thought it was an interesting one. I think that it might have been Mercedes Villalba that also raised that point. And of course, that might be an option for getting around the risk of vexatious complaints if that was something that the shooting industry felt was really problematic for them. I do bear in mind, however, what I think it was the Scottish Countryside Alliance said, that that could be bureaucratic for them, and I genuinely want to see this be a proportionate approach. However, I don't believe that the bill creates or exacerbates the risk of vexatious complaints. For example, we have these provisions already in place in England and Wales, and I'm not aware of any rise in the number of vexatious complaints there. However, of course, if that were a risk, if it were something that the shooting industry in particular were very concerned about, I would be pleased to work with them to discuss how we might avoid that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. You've touched on the issue of loopholes and where you think the dangers might lie. I wonder how you weighed up concern that was expressed on animal welfare grounds about the dangers of such loopholes. As you've already mentioned, the concern you had about how some groups might adapt their behaviour to get round the aims of the bill. I wonder if you could say a little bit more about that, but also if you could say if you're still satisfied that the arrangements set out in the bill which allow for multiple dogs, although not in the form of a pack, whether that interpretation and that part of the bill is adequate to meet the animal welfare grounds of the aims of the bill as well.
Thank you for the question. Yes, I think it does. I think it's balanced. I've always had confidence in the two-dog limit, that was a reasonable way to ensure that element of control, and that element of control therefore ensures that the risk of animals being chased and killed in the countryside is reduced. That is the core purpose of the two-dog limit. And then of course I think there, the challenge then is not about the concept of the two-dog limit, but it's about folks' understanding of exactly how it applies in each situation, and that's what we've worked very hard to make clear. That's what the committee have worked hard to make clear as well through all the evidence sessions that you have taken. And the way that, and I know that my colleagues have spoken with you, setting out how it applies under the bill, I tend to try and put it into my own sort of non-official layperson's language to make sure that it's absolutely clear. So for me, it's about, you can go out on a rough shoot, the activity that you're undertaking is the flushing, searching for, stalking. The two-dog limit applies to that activity. And that means that, so for example, in the course of a rough shoot, if the bill team went on a rough shoot, Leah and I could go out. If I had two dogs, she could come with me. She could shoot the quarry that I flushed, so long as she didn't have her own dogs. If three of us went out, provided there were still only two dogs between the three of us and the others didn't have any, they could shoot the quarry that was flushed. There's different permutations, but I do think we're getting to the point where it's clearer.
Just add as well, the Minister has already made the point that the evidence that we heard from the shooting community about the sort of level of control and training of the dogs and what happens on rough shoots, I think, also provides us with the reassurance that the welfare risks are sufficiently managed in the way that we're talking about rough shoots and the interaction with the bill.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. I just want to, for the record, know what you define a rough shoot as.
It's a good question. Thanks, Rachel, for it. There is my experience in bringing this bill forward tells me that there is no one definition, that it would be a very vexed activity to try and have a definitive definition. There are many permutations of what people think constitutes a rough shoot, and my team and I have worked hard to speak to as many people as possible to have the widest possible view on what constitutes a rough shoot. But it does coalesce around this activity where a line of people move across ground with dogs who would flush the quarry to be shot if possible and retrieved, often for sport, sometimes for the food element attached to that, and I know that you discussed this at your round table, but there is a wildlife management element to it sometimes as well. But there's no one definition, and I would guard against seeking to find one.
Okay. And the types of dogs that are used, what would your team suggest that the types of dogs that people who go rough shooting use?
So gun dogs, Labradors, Spaniels, etc.
And you said those dogs tend to be trained and under control by the person who's going out with them.
Yes, I've heard a huge amount of evidence about how well trained they are, how controlled they are, how they don't form packs, how they don't chase, how they're, I think it was Alex Hogg talked about how soft-mouthed they are, and I have my own Labrador who I know is very soft-mouthed.
Okay, so in the terms of a vexatious complaint, do you think that it's proportionate and fair that those who go out rough shooting, you've just described that if you and Leah go out rough shooting and you maybe invite Hugh as well, you only take two dogs. Do you think it's fair and proportionate to curtail rural activities in, when you say and you, in your opening remarks that you're confident that individuals who do this conduct themselves in a way that they have landowner permission and that they have their dogs under control? So do you think it's fair and proportionate?
Yes, I do. I do. And I think it is because, firstly, it's important we have consistency across the bill and across the various types of hunting. And secondly, I think it's proportionate because the changes that may be required to some activities currently regarded as rough shooting are minimal. They are minimal and they are proportionate. Many people already comply with what we would be asking them to comply with. I think the changes are minimal and I think they are proportionate. And from everything that I've heard, I have confidence that it will not be difficult to ensure that those well-trained dogs do as will be required under the new regulations.
And I mean, we heard from Hugh that a couple of sessions ago that the team looked at YouTube videos and Googled what rough shooting was. But have you been on a rough shoot? You said that it was part of the bill and it hadn't been overlooked. However, we heard in evidence that subsequently, you know, we've had to have three committee sessions with regard to this because it seemed to have been overlooked. Do you know, in terms of how it works, how Jim Fairley was talking about the quartering and the dogs forming a pack? I mean, have you had experience of that? Have you watched it on a YouTube video? Do you think there's a high likelihood that a dog would stalk, flush, and somebody else would shoot the quarry that another person's dog had flushed?
So in terms of my own experience, I don't think that's particularly relevant to my role as a minister taking this bill through. But I do represent a rural constituency. I live in the heart of the countryside. I do observe these things as a matter of course, just living where I do. The point about YouTube, the only YouTube video I've watched on this is the one that Basque helpfully produced and invited me to watch at the Parliament, and I suspect that was the same video that my colleagues were referring to. But we have, as we would with any aspect of the bill, undertaken substantial stakeholder engagement. In fact, I was just reflecting last night that since Lord Bonamy published his report in 2002 Act in 2016, this issue and the bill as a whole, appreciate we're talking about rough shooting, but this has been intensely scrutinised. We had Lord Bonamy in front of the Eclair Committee in 2017, a public consultation in 2018, a second consultation in 2021, The committee's own call for evidence on the bill earlier this year, your 5 public and 3 private sessions at stage one, we've had a stage one report, we've had further correspondence between me and the committee, then we had the debate, the bill was unanimously passed, and today is the third session that you've held specifically on rough shooting. So there has been a huge amount of stakeholder consultation and a great deal of scrutiny.
Well, thank you for reminding me of that. I don't know how many times rough shooting has been mentioned within all the sessions that you have described, other than the last 3. But I just also want to ask you there about the vexatious claims around using rough shooting as a cover for hare coursing. What type of dogs do hare coursers use?
Well, I think this was discussed at your last session to be lurchers, whippets, others of that kind.
Okay. And, I mean, do you believe that Police Scotland will increase the number of prosecutions of hare coursing? Because currently there is, you know, a lot of reports of hare coursing, but a lack of prosecutions. And DC Telfer said that he would provide us with evidence as regards to he couldn't provide us with the evidence of the number of reports because there is no such thing as a rural marker for hare coursing. So how will the Scottish Government, in their aim to ensure that animal welfare is at the highest standards, how will they follow the progress of this bill in the aim to prosecute more people who are hare coursing?
Thanks for the question. So I think the first part was, do I think there will be an improvement? Yes, I do. Well, I certainly hope so. And the objective behind the inclusion of rabbits, as we have discussed, was because Police Scotland and others have told us that as they are perhaps trying to prosecute, or sorry, they wouldn't prosecute, but gather evidence on hare coursing, they know that shooting rabbits is often used as a guise. So it should follow that if we bring rabbits within the scope of this, that guise will no longer exist. And that will ease the detection of crime on the part of Police Scotland. And in terms of the impact of the bill, I think, as with other bits of legislation, the Scottish Government will always track the success or the impact that it has. I don't know that there's anything specific in the face of the bill, but the Government will always track the impact of what we do.
Yeah. We publish annually a report on wildlife crime.
Of course, yeah.
It is difficult to sometimes isolate wildlife crime from other offences that may have been committed alongside it. But the police, I think, are getting better at that. There is a clearer focus on wildlife crime, so we do get better data on it, but it's still not as good as we would like it to be. But we will certainly be monitoring that in relation to hare coursing, which we know is quite a sort of significant numbers of offences and complaints about it, and a lot of farmers object to it very strongly taking place on their land.
On that point, would you be willing to look at possibly an amendment that would look at improved data gathering in terms of isolating specific wildlife crimes, rural crimes, and committing to a sort of reporting here in the Scottish Parliament as to those rural crimes?
I'll consider all amendments.
Thank you.
Head of stage 2.
Thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. One of the issues that's been raised in the past has been about the definition of a pack and how it might be identified. Are you still content with the definition that you have as a working definition of what a pack constitutes?
Yes, I am, and I'm just leafing through my notes here because I had pulled out exactly the part of the bill. So the bill has, as we know, the 2-dog limit, and it speaks to, in each of the exceptions, reasonable steps being taken to ensure that any dog used in the activity does not join with others to form a pack of more than 2 dogs. And therefore, for the purposes of the bill, a pack will mean more than 2 dogs.
In that case, in your view, there doesn't need to be anything added to the face of the bill to make the matter clearer?
Not in my view, but as I've said, I'd consider amendments ahead of stage 2.
Thank you.
Janie Minto. Thank you, Convener. I'm interested in hearing about more. Hugh Dignan, when you last gave evidence, we asked about a person using two dogs alongside another person using two dogs and how these dogs may crisscross. I'd just like you to confirm for the record again how you see this bill ensuring that the activity is connected with the right person. So the two dogs, the four dogs perhaps from the two people if they're working together, how you see this act supporting or otherwise that activity.
Sure, thank you. And I'll let you might want to come in afterwards, but from my perspective, we have section 1.4 in the bill, which is this issue of using a dog, and it defines who will be regarded as having used it in the case that an offence is committed. And it's essentially an anti-avoidance provision, so that if you're involved in unlawful hunting, you cannot claim to have not committed an offence simply because you weren't controlling the dogs. So it means that you're treated as having used the dog, even if it's not under your control or direction. And in terms of practical examples of what that would mean, well, in traditional fox hunting, I think it's obvious that this would include, I think, those following the hunt, as well as those, you know, that one or two individual that was controlling the pack. And in rough shooting, it means that if you shoot someone else's quarry flushed with their dogs, you're regarded as having been part of that activity. And again, if just to draw out the examples, if Leah and I go rough shooting each with our own one or two dogs, as long as we use the dogs separately to flush separate quarry and comply with the conditions in section 6, that will be fine. If Leah is using two dogs, she could not shoot a rabbit flushed by me, if I had one or two dogs, and this is because we would be treating as using all four for the purposes of that section 1.4 of the bill. But if Leah, Hugh and I, we could lawfully go out with two dogs, Leah controlling the dogs and Hugh and I without dogs and shooting the quarry. So it has different permutations, but that's how that provision works. And it's there to make sure that, as I say, there is no avoidance of having been involved in the offence because you weren't directing the dogs.
Thank you, Minister. And I think the evidence that we received, certainly in the round table last week, showed the need for the shooters to be in direct control of the dogs and the understanding that if a dog did start chasing, then the control that the dog handler had would result in that dog stopping. Is that?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. Control is a really fundamental part of this bill. And, you know, I know we're here to talk about rough shooting, but the bill as a whole is supposed to be about control being important and it being readily obvious when control has been lost. And the two-dog limit allows that to be much more easily picked up.
Thank you.
Just on that, that just adds more confusion and again makes me think that what you define as rough shooting is not exactly what it is. So you suggested that somebody with a gun and somebody with dogs would have to be associated with each other. Whereas in practice, in a shoot you might have, or a rough shoot, you might have five people with guns and eight or nine or ten people, each with two dogs, who are not associated with the shooters, but ultimately those shooters require those dogs to work to flush the rabbits or the game. So can you just explain again the scenario where there might be one person with a gun who doesn't own any dogs, but two people who are beaters, if you like, with two dogs each? Is that illegal?
You would two dogs per activity is the rule. So, and the activity is stalking, flushing, searching for. And however many people were working with that individual who had two dogs, they would be, the whole group is regarded as having the two dog limit.
So would that be illegal? My scenario, two beaters with two dogs each, with one person, individual with a gun.
No, that would be four dogs, one activity. If they worked separately, if they pursued individual quarry, if the dogs didn't work together, that would be fine.
But the thing is, when you have a rough shoot, you have four dogs, for example, working through a piece of rough ground, flushing every piece of prey that comes in front of them. And if there's one person outside that undercover shooting, ultimately these dogs are working towards the gun. But they don't belong to the guy with the gun. They belong to the beaters who are flushing. So
you could have one beater with two dogs.
So the scenario I'm looking at, two beaters, two dogs each.
I've said that would be unlawful.
Okay, but that's a scenario that often plays out in a rough shoot.
Well, in those circumstances, that would be part of the minimal adaptation that would be required.
Okay, so where I'm struggling is we've heard how intrinsically different fox hunting and hare coursing is and how we can identify those behaviours because the different dogs are used or the different behaviours that the dogs have. And if it's so clear, surely it would be easy to construct an exemption to identify what rough shooting is. And then we wouldn't have Police Scotland having to work out how many beaters, how many people with guns, which dogs were doing which, whether they were working together or whatever, and ultimately taking the police away from ensuring those easily identified areas of illegal activity are being identified and prosecuted.
So I think the crux of your point is, again, going back to an exemption that would take rough shooting out with the scope of the bill. First of all, you said, with a definition, it'd be extremely difficult to define rough shooting. But that's a minor point as compared with the much bigger points that we've already rehearsed, namely that you would create a glaring loophole in the bill, that the two-dog limit would then apply to everybody else, including farmers trying to protect their lambs from predation, but not to groups
of people. Can you give us some examples of where a clearly defined rough shoot, as you say that you understand, could be identified as hare coursing or illegal fox hunting? Where could that happen?
These are utterly hypothetical questions, and ultimately it's for the police, who I have confidence in their ability to observe what is happening in the countryside and to determine what it is. Now, of course, I want that to be as clear as possible, but I'm not going to entertain increasingly hypothetical situations.
But one of the reasons you said it was important was to stop activity that might happen in the future. Surely that's hypothetical.
Well, of course, in some ways it is, but equally we have proof that after the 2002 Act, and I know this was discussed at your roundtable, that nobody talked about flushing to guns prior to 2002, and thereafter we know we have evidence that it became a cover for illegal hunting. So there's form in that regard.
So my question was, where do you think cover for illegal activities could be used, or rough shooting could be used for that cover?
I'm sorry, I don't understand the question.
So you were suggesting that the two-dog limit or whatever, we're not going to have an exemption for rough shooting because in the future that might be used as a cover for illegal hunting activity. What I'm asking is, in which circumstances might rough shooting, as we know it exists at the moment, be used as a cover for something illegal in the future?
I think if
there was no limit on the number of dogs that could be associated with rough shooting, you could envisage a scenario where a couple of people could take 10 dogs out with guns and say they were out rough shooting. Now, that, on the face of it, could be exactly the same as a foot pack, the way that operates. Now, the only difference would be, as we know, most likely the breed of dogs. But we also know that to try and define something purely on the basis of the breed of dogs is going to be problematic.
But you'd expect the police to do that?
Well, no, we're not asking the police to do that. The police have said that they will look at that as part of forming their overall picture. But we're not seeking to define an activity by virtue of the breed of dog that's employed, because we know it will be sort of pushed at, that people will use crossbreeds, hybrids and new breeds of dogs and so on. So that is not a satisfactory way of proceeding. So we can see that even though at present rough shooting doesn't look like someone taking a pack of dogs out in pursuit of a fox, but you could also see how an exemption for rough shooting could be pushed at its very limit so that that is, in fact, what happens.
Alistair Allen and then Karen Adam. I'm just going to go to Alistair on this point and then I can go back. I'll come to Alistair and then I'll come back to you, Jim.
I've no idea. We might be about to make the same point for all I know. I don't know. But it was just you run through a series of scenarios there and gone through them one by one. Mm-hmm. Some of them, as you say, are hypothetical. But of course, we have had evidence from some stakeholders that the police who pointed to some of the difficulties they felt they might face in distinguishing between some of these scenarios. So I wondered, in weighing up how the bill was put together, did you consider the option of going in the other direction? This is not a position I'm advocating, I hasten to add, where the limit was simply set at two dogs per shoot.
That would create an inconsistency in policy terms, but I can understand and I could see why that would be an easier situation evidence-wise for the police. And although I will not put words in Police Scotland's mouth, I suspect that their concerns about the position as it stands, and some of this was expressed last week, is about believing that a two-dog limit per event would be easier for the police. Would that be proportionate for the rough shooters? I don't think it would. Would it create inconsistencies in the bill? Yes. But it would certainly be easier evidentially.
Thank you.
Jim.
Thank you, convener. I'm going to try and rewind back to where we were. But the point that we just made there about the purpose of this bill was not to stop hunting altogether. And the ability for rough shooters to be able to continue to carry out their activities, which they do perfectly legitimately, with minor adaptations. Mm-hmm. Now, we had Ross Ewan last week given what I think was a genuine position on the point that the general public might not understand what the position is, and this bill will be announced in the public domain as being hunting with dogs has now been banned. Is there something that the government can do in terms of the right of responsible access, updating the right of responsible access so that people understand that rough shooting is a legitimate thing to do in the countryside and that it doesn't fall within this unless somebody is going to use it as a loophole? So is there something that the government can do at a later stage to make sure that the public understand what the position of this bill is as well?
Yes, absolutely. And I have tried to do that from the start. So, from the very inception of the bill, I have been very clear that this is about closing loopholes of the past, preventing others from opening. This is about making sure that what's been unlawful for 20 years no longer continues, but that, for example, farmers, environmentalists, conservationists will still have to access and use dogs in the countryside. So that's been part of the messaging from the government from the beginning. And I'm committed to that ongoing dialogue and explanation of what's expected and what people can expect, not least in the case of vexatious complaints, for example, where I said I'd be happy to work with the industry to provide guidance and to provide messaging about what people should expect and when to expect it. However, I think it was you, Jim, in response to that point from Basque, who said that ultimately, as regards the criminal law, it's not what the public perceive and their view of it. It is ultimately for law enforcement, who are very well adapt to making these judgments and observing actions in the countryside.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. And I'll quote you, Detective Sergeant Telford, here on the specific point we're talking about. We have talked about evidence and so forth, but we'll still be able to use common sense and the degree of judgment to ask whether, in the balance of probability, an activity is a legitimate shoot or something else. The common sense approach will take into account types of dogs that are used too. So the police are already on board with how this is going to work. But I do understand Ross Ewing's and others' concern that the public might not understand as well as we do. And the convener's point of pardon the pun, taking you down so many rabbit holes of all the different permutations that could or could not happen. That's the stuff that the shooting fraternity are coming back with and saying, well, what if this happens? Well, I understand that there's no way that you can legislate for all of the possible scenarios, but the way shoots are conducted at the moment, they will be able to manage themselves. Their concern is that the police are going to be called out every other day on the basis that I think there has to be an understanding there's going to be common sense here, and the relationship between the police and the shooting community has to be a strong one. Would you accept that?
Yes, and I would accept that it already is, and a lot of that is underpinned by the really strict regulation of firearms, etc., and the relationship that exists between police and those who they know have firearms and who undertake shooting activity in their areas. Look, I know, and I'm not going to pretend that Police Scotland have said it's cut and dry, everything's straightforward, and I know specifically that Mr Telford raised some issues about the two-dog limit, which Alistair Allen raised. However, there is always, by its very nature, going to be challenges with evidence in a rural setting. It's the same with gathering evidence in a domestic setting. It's not easily corroborated and it happens out of view. But what I was very pleased to see come forward was that explanation from DS Telford about what they would consider to build the picture, and that was the breed of dog, the distance between the dogs, what reasonable steps had been taken to separate any that joined up, consulting witnesses, discussing with experts, seizing phones, and as you said, common sense.
Thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I want to ask, in regards to animal welfare, I mean, this is obviously what this bill is mainly about, and there are different types of hunts that use dogs in different ways, different breeds of dogs, and we've heard how people manage and train these animals and how differently they behave. So in regards to the animal welfare concerns, what would be the differing concerns for animal welfare in different hunting scenarios? Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it does make sense, and there are obviously different degrees of concern between the different activities, and that is, well, that exists for a whole range of different reasons, including the way that dogs are trained, what they're trained to do, how well controlled they are, how what the oversight is like for each of the types of hunting. But actually, my point is that I am not differentiating between the different types of hunting. I think that just creates uncertainty. And rather than do that, rather than differentiate, rather than try and treat differently, I want a consistent approach, which ultimately is about regulating the use of dogs in the course of hunting in the Scottish countryside, you know, not regardless of how they're used, but that consistent thread through the bill, so that it applies to all dogs used in the course of hunting rather than in different types of hunting, which would be fraught with opportunities for loopholes if we broke that down.
Yeah, that's really helpful, thank you. Because I do note that in the past, with the past legislation, this is, well, what we're hoping to close here is that there are loopholes that have been created because it wasn't as broad before.
Yeah, absolutely. And I come back to Lord Bonamy's point, who is an expert in the problems of the former bill, that his view was that this was well crafted and made it simpler and clearer.
Okay. Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
Where are we now?
The topic two.
My apologies. This is about interpret. We've probably already covered this. The Scottish Government's current thinking on how to interpret Section 6 provisions in the game of rough shooting. But I think we've more or less covered that, haven't we?
Yep, okay, yep. Mercedes.
I think my question actually has probably also already been covered earlier on by Karen Adam around enforcement. So
I know that in certain circumstances, if a group is organising an event, they're required to notify the police. And so what we spoke briefly about at last week's roundtable was the possibility of a kind of voluntary notification for those who are concerned about potential vexatious allegations, that they could, you know, self-report ahead of time just to make the local police aware of their activities, and, you know, that way facilitate any sort of drop-in or whatever. Is that something that the Scottish Government would look at facilitating? I don't know, around, I guess, not on the face of the bill, but in terms of guidance later on, or if maybe you could outline any other kind of measures you're considering or looking at just to aid enforcement.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for the question. And I was interested when, I think it was you, Mercedes Velba, who raised this at the round table last week. And I thought it was an interesting point, because for me, at the very conducive session that you had, I think that we managed to get clarity on what was expected during a rough shoot. I think we managed to understand the conditions that would be expected, and I think we went through how for some part that wouldn't require much change, for others it would require a bit of adaptation. And all of that then appeared to boil down, especially from Basque's view, to their concern about, you know, accepting that, but their concern about vexatious complaints. Now, if that is something that is a concern from the shooting industry, again, of course, I'm happy to work with them about how to mitigate the risk of that. I've already said that I haven't seen any evidence of it increasing as a risk with the changes in England and Wales. I don't know that the shooting industry would be receptive to more bureaucracy. But if it's them who's coming to me and saying to me, we are very concerned about vexatious complaints, that would be something we could consider in order to mitigate that. How receptive to that they would be, I'm not sure.
Thank you.
You just wish it.
Thanks, Convener. We've talked a lot about potential enforcement issues and sort of the clarification. I just wonder if you could explain to us what discussions you've had with Police Scotland about enforcement and about the different scenarios that we heard from last week.
Yes, I haven't spoken with Police Scotland since your roundtable. I'm not sure if officials have, but we've certainly been in ongoing contact with them right from the beginning of the bill. We've been able to clarify certain points about, for example, the training of police dogs. I think it was yourself who raised that at the Stage 1 debate, and we'll continue to discuss with them how to make the best situation for enforcement that we can. I suppose this is a sort of odd situation where we're having this, I think, helpful but nonetheless extraordinary evidence session, but I'll certainly be engaging prior to Stage 2 again.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think obviously, as you have picked up from last week's discussion, there's the concern about the vexatious reports, and for example, could the police just, if they had a complaint, could they close down? Could they close down an activity that was taking place?
So that would be a question for the police. I'm not proposing any additional enforcement powers within this bill than that which exists already in legislation managing these activities in the countryside. But ultimately, how the police respond to complaints, vexatious or otherwise, is always a matter for them.
Thank you.
Just on that, what would your expectations be if there was a suggestion of illegal activity within a rough shoot and the police were called? Would you expect them to stop the shoot, to allow them to undertake an investigation? Would you allow them to, for that shoot to proceed? Or what would your view on that be?
Scottish ministers will not direct Police Scotland on how to conduct their investigations.
Should that not be clearer within the legislation?
Well, in response to Beatrice Wishart, I set out that the investigative powers of the police are not changed by this bill. They are, as they currently stand, within other pieces of legislation, including, for example, the regulation of firearms. I'm not going to deliberate on how Police Scotland do their job.
Okay, just on the firearms, would you expect, if there was illegal activity identified at a rough shoot that the police would seize temporarily firearms from those involved?
Again, that would be done in accordance with legislation already existing, which regulates the use and the removal in certain circumstances of firearms, and this bill makes no difference to that.
Okay, but that so you don't know whether that would be the case or not?
It's not a case of not knowing. It's a case of I'm part of the executive and I'm not going to direct Police Scotland on how to conduct their activities.
Okay, Rachel Hamilton.
Oh, it was actually just a supplementary going back to using rough shooting as a cover for hair coursing. I just wondered if the Minister could tell the committee at what time of the day does hair coursing happen and at what time of the year does hair coursing happen?
I don't have an answer to that, I'm afraid. I'm not an expert in the...
Would it happen, do you think, the same time as rough shooting? Is that why you think it could be a cover for rough shooting?
Hugh's just saying to me here, a good point is that I don't think we've ever said it would be a cover for rough shooting.
So,
I mean, I don't think we know hair coursing primarily at night, and we're not saying that rough shooting would be a cover for hair coursing.
What is it a cover for then? What is it that you're saying? Because it's been referenced many times. Well, what is rough shooting a cover for?
Rough shooting at present is not a cover for anything.
What could it be a cover for?
If there was no limit on the number of dogs, and the only way that a person could take more than two dogs out to the countryside in pursuit of some animal, and there was an exemption saying that you could do that as a rough shooter, people could claim they were doing any number of activities and say it was rough shooting.
So which activities?
Well, I mean, hunting foxes for one.
Right. So you were saying that people who rough shoot would go out with hounds?
I'm saying that if there was an exemption for rough shooting, unless it said it was only applied to certain breeds of dog, then yes, they could take hounds with them. And we know that trying to limit any exemption to certain breeds of dogs would be problematic.
Yeah. So how will the prosecutions of hair coursing increase then if it's not specifically being looked at because that's been used as the inclusion of rabbits within the bill?
Well, it's because at present people who are going hair coursing sometimes claim that they're doing it after rabbits, which is currently lawful. So by bringing rabbits within the scope of this bill, it would then make that unlawful and they wouldn't be able to. So hair coursers wouldn't be able to claim that they were out after rabbits.
Okay, so it's not a cover. No, it's definitely not a cover for rough shooting. Okay, no. Because you said that hair coursing happens at night.
Yes.
Right, okay.
As far as I know, I mean, yes, primarily I think.
Okay, and rough shooting doesn't?
Again, as far as I know.
Right. So can I just ask the Minister that with regards to the conversation that Beatrice Wishart was having there about the investigative powers of Police Scotland, have you had a conversation with Police Scotland about the potential numbers of increased vexatious complaints or otherwise in terms of their role and their ability to ensure that they are carrying out what the government want them to do, which is to carry out the intention of stopping whatever you're trying to stop within this bill. So have they got the ability to do that with the cuts in Police Scotland budget?
Convener, again, there's a number of questions there, and I'm increasingly finding it difficult to follow exactly what it is that Rachel Hamilton is trying to ask. As I said, we've had ongoing engagement with Police Scotland. We will continue to do that, and we will do it as issues arise. Last week at your roundtable, there's no doubt that once the operation of this as it pertains to rough shooting was explained, the risk of vexatious complaints was something that was raised by BASC, among others. And I will, and my officials will, engage again with Police Scotland on that, likely before the formal move to stage two. And we'll keep doing that. And when it comes to enforcement, when it comes to investigative powers, when it comes to police funding, I have confidence in Police Scotland and their ability to fulfil these requirements. And I know that DS Telford said that you know, he has views on what would be better within the bill, but ultimately what's passed, they will take it and they will work with it. Mm-hmm. And
Briefly, Rachel, thank you.
The guidance that you said that you would produce, will that come, at what stage will that come, so that there's more clarity? And apologies for not being clear in the intention of my questions, and I found it very difficult to understand the legislation and the drafting of the bill, and so therefore it has been difficult to articulate questions. So what is the, will you produce the guidance that you talked about in your introduction before stage three?
So that's it's not a problem at all. I mean, I hope that this session has provided clarity. I hope the additional sessions on rough shooting have provided clarity. There are inherent complications in producing a piece of law like this. That's probably why a very well-intentioned bit of work in 2002 ended up creating loopholes for the next 20 years. So I don't think any of us should pretend that this is not a complicated area of law. But I go back again to what Lord Bonamy said about this that we have produced being a great deal simpler and clearer. And I haven't said that I will produce guidance. I've said that I would be happy to discuss the production of guidance with the shooting industry if that's something that would help in that bedding in period that I think was discussed at the round table.
Thank you. Can I ask, Jenny, do you have any further questions on the flushing aspect?
I have no further questions, and I think the Minister's already been here for 5 minutes longer, 6 minutes longer.
Thank you. Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Minister, for your time today. It's just a very quick follow-up on actually a question from Alistair Allen earlier on about the definition of pack. I believe you said that for the purposes of the bill, a pack will mean more than two dogs. And I just wanted to clarify, is the number of dogs the only factor in a pack, or will activity also be a consideration?
The number of dogs is the principal factor. But, of course, they would have to... They couldn't be opposite sides of the field from one another to be a pack. So the activity, they would have to be together.
OK, thank you.
Thank you very much. That brings us to the session. I appreciate you coming in with your team. I hope that by stage three we won't have a bill that requires, unlike the Minister, students of the future to look at the loopholes. So I'm sure we can get to the stage where the bill is clear and the Parliament can accept it. So thank you very much for your time this morning. It's very much appreciated. We will suspend the minutes for 10 minutes to allow witnesses to change over.
Welcome back. Our second item of business today is an evidence session on avian flu in Scotland. We have scheduled an hour for this session, and I welcome to the meeting Sheila Voss, the Chief Veterinary Officer, and Alistair Douglas, the Head of Animal Disease Control Branch. Sheila, would you like to make an opening statement?
Yes. This year has been unprecedented in terms of avian flu. That's a word I don't use lightly. We said it last year. This year has been much worse. The context is that in Scotland, we have confirmed 8 premises with avian flu this year. 6 of these have been commercial premises. 1 was a very small commercial premises. To put that into context, there have been 125 premises confirmed within England. And so, whilst the situation in Scotland is bad, it is nowhere near as bad as other parts of GB. Avian flu is a disease of birds. It's a viral disease. It is a similar virus, but not the same virus, as causes flu in other species, including humans. And it's predominantly spread by wild birds. It gets into poultry flocks and then has a devastating effect in poultry flocks. So if avian flu gets into a poultry flock, what we do is require the compulsory slaughter of all the birds in that flock to prevent the disease from spreading further, either within poultry flocks or indeed back into wild bird populations. That's probably enough of an introduction to begin with, but I'm very happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Sheila. You know, it's important to understand the seriousness of the outbreak in Scotland and the risk to Scottish producers. In previous weeks, we heard some information or evidence of the wild bird population and the devastating impact it had on goose numbers, for example, along the Solway Firth. What is the tie-up with the density or the intensity of the disease in the wild bird population in Scotland and the potential knock-on effect to the commercial flocks?
So wild birds spread the disease. They, particularly water birds, spend their summer in their Arctic breeding grounds where they mix with populations from other parts of the world. When they are in the Arctic, the viruses mix and can change so that each year it's a different strain. These birds then come back to their overwintering grounds, such as the Solway or the Angus Basin or other parts of the country, and they, particularly waterfowl, can survive with the virus for a period of time. So they excrete that virus, particularly in their faeces, and that can be picked up by poultry. And that's the main route of incursion into poultry. It's generally contact with wild bird faeces, but it's often indirect contact.
OK, we heard of a mounting toll of geese and gulls in Findhorn Bay. Is that something we should be concerned about?
To an extent, yes. We do monitor wild bird die-offs so that we encourage members of the public, and we have agreements with wardens, people in the Wetlands and Wildlife Trust, and Nature Scot are working with us to make sure that we're notified of die-offs. And in that case, animals will be tested. So far this season, and administratively the season runs from the 1st of October, we've had 19 confirmed positive wild birds, but that's about half the number that have been submitted. So it's not the only cause of death out there. And so the small number, again, in England and Wales, they're in 300 plus. So it's a small percentage, but yes, it is of concern.
And is it season? So you've talked about the migration of birds, but you know, we know that COVID was worse in the winter, and the virus is supposed to decline in the summer with temperatures and things. Does the same sort of profile work for avian flu? Are we likely to see an increase of the
transmission of bird flu just because of the nature of the virus during winter or in the spring? Or
yes, exactly. Flu viruses generally like cold, damp conditions, and so they survive much better in the winter and will spread and remain infective for longer than in the summer, where ultraviolet, sunshine, high temperatures, dry, if we get a dry summer, will kill it. Mm-hmm. Last year was unusual in that normally we would say the flu season was October through to about March time. Last year we continued to get cases through the summer in GB, and indeed we in Scotland had a case in Orkney in July.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's helpful. Ariane Burgess.
Morning.
Morning.
I'd be interested to know what work you've been doing to gather evidence of farm-to-farm transfer of highly pathogenic avian influenza in Scotland.
Yep, we do full epidemiological investigations on every premises that's confirmed. These can take a bit of time, so at the moment the findings are preliminary, but there is no evidence of farm-to-farm transfer. Some of the cases that we've had have been within a group of farms, and so we were interested in seeing if it was human movements from farm to farm that were the problem, but it looks like there were lapses in biosecurity that may be the explanation. Things like buildings that were not totally secure from rodents or wild birds.
Sorry, can you just say a little bit more about that? So there might have been lapses in biosecurity in the farms that are
within
the same
farm cluster. Yes. What I didn't say in my introduction was that of the cases that we've had, 5 out of the 6 commercial premises are in the one ownership group. And these are all birds that have been housed since early October. So only one of the 6 commercial premises has been truly free range at the point of housing. So the virus in the other 5 has found its way in from the environment into the house with the birds. And there is some evidence that when birds are housed, it needs less virus to start and to sustain an infection than when they're outside. Again, with parallels to COVID, being outside in a football stadium was safer than being inside in a dance hall.
Could you say a little bit more about what lapses in biosecurity might have taken place in those 5 farms?
Yes. The preliminary epidemiology would suggest that there was a rodent problem in some of them. There were potential problems with vehicles going between, and the foot dips, the cleansing and disinfection points were not as effective as they could have been.
And are personnel moving between from one farm to another?
The farm staff that are doing the day-to-day care are dedicated, okay, but there is some management movement.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Mercedes.
Thank you. I just had a question about the, the effect of the disease on different types of birds. Is it equally lethal amongst wild birds and poultry? If it's more lethal to one than the other, is that to do with breeding or immune systems, use of antibiotics? Could you say a little bit about why it has a different impact on different...
Yeah, it's a viral disease, so there is no use of antibiotics. But different types of birds have different susceptibility to the virus. So waterfowl are generally the natural host for flu viruses, and so they tend to be somewhat resistant to it. They will get the virus and multiply it up a bit, but are still able to move and fly, whereas turkeys on the other extreme, as soon as they get the virus, they're pretty sick and die. And indeed, one of the signs of avian flu in captive populations is a rapidly increasing mortality. So in one of our cases, we went from 5 dead overnight to 19 to 100 to about 3,000 in the space of 4 or 5 days. That was chickens, not turkeys. Turkeys are even worse.
Sir Alan.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I wonder if you could say a wee bit more just about the extent of the outbreak, and without minimising the extent of the outbreak, given its impact, not least on wild birds, as we've seen. Can you say more about, firstly, the comparison in terms of the outbreak in Scotland and England, but also the geographic concentrations of the outbreak, both in Scotland and in England?
Okay. So England started off very much with an outbreak in East Anglia, which is probably not surprising because they have the highest poultry concentration within England. But since then, it has spread over much of England, although, interestingly, not in Cumbria or Northumberland particularly. In Scotland, this year, we've had two backyard flocks in Orkney, a very small producer in Lewis, who had about 300 birds, and then we've had one free-range flock in Ayrshire, and the rest, the other five commercial flocks, are in Aberdeenshire, and they're the ones that are all linked. I do have a map here that I'm happy to pass round, which will show the density. Can you pass that over? It may be interesting just to have a look and see. The figures are slightly out of date. They're from the end of last week. But it does demonstrate that Scotland, in comparison, has very little.
And can I ask, does the pattern of distribution within Scotland lend itself to making it more difficult or more easy to control?
We do have some clusters of poultry, particularly in the northeast and in the borders, but we don't have the level of density of poultry populations elsewhere. However, the single most important thing, given that it's not spread from one premises to another, is that people maintain as good biosecurity as they can.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Hello, Sheila. I wanted to know, there's been reports of numbers of culls through FOIs. I wondered how many culls has actually been in Scotland?
So we've killed birds on all the infected premises, and the total number is 224,000 across the whole of Scotland, as to round numbers. To put that into comparison, England have killed 1.673 million turkeys and 2.003 million chickens, plus ducks and geese.
And what is the percentage of the total flock in Scotland?
Oh, gosh, it's 1%, 1.5%, thereabouts.
And in comparison to England, you know?
They're about 2.5%, 3%.
So they're not far in front of us. It's just that density is greater.
Well, the difference between 1.5 and 3 is
compared to the density of the number of stock, as you said. How many species have been infected to date of avian flu?
In Scotland, only poultry amongst commercial species. In wild birds, 20, I think. It's there or thereabouts. It's 20, 25 species.
Okay.
It changes almost on a daily basis because we're continually taking samples and getting them analysed from wild birds. So.
Okay. And you said that Northumberland and Cumbria so far hadn't been affected. However, it's a question about how the disease spreads between wild birds and domestic birds. Why do you think in those areas that have, you know, coastal areas to them, that it hasn't spread? Because Robert Thompson, who's NFUS, has said that avian flu doesn't stop at the borders, or Carlisle, he said. And I'm sure you're familiar with what he said and the concerns that he has with regards to being put on an equal footing in terms of restrictions, which is a question that's coming up. So I won't ask you about that. But why do you think that there has not been clusters in both of those areas, considering the wild bird population of Northumberland and Cumbria?
So there are two different facets to that. The one is to do with migratory patterns. Although we tend to think of the Arctic summer grounds for geese as being a soup for virus, actually, the birds that we get coming back to Scotland tend to come from Iceland, Greenland, Svalbard, so the northwestern part of the Arctic, whereas a lot of the birds coming into Eastern Europe come from, into Eastern England, come from Eastern Europe, so they're coming from Siberia, Estonia, Latvia, Baltic countries. And so there may be a difference in the virus that they're carrying. There's also quite good evidence in England that some of the problem that they're seeing is virus that has survived over the summer and is now causing a problem again. Last year, again, we didn't have anything like the same number of problems that they had down south. And so the assumption is that the other part of the jigsaw is that there is just less virus around in Scotland, even although we do have substantial numbers of wild birds.
And can I just clarify, is it the same virus, and which virus is it?
It's H5N1. Flu viruses are classified according to their hemagglutinin, the H number and the N number. And that gives a broad categorisation. But like human flu viruses, they're constantly adapting and evolving. So H5N1 is the broad type, but there can be lots of different changes. And what we do is genetic analysis, gene sequencing, to understand pathways, how it transmits, how it's adapting. And that's why we're relatively comfortable saying some of what's happening in England is a spillover from last year rather than all being new introductions this year.
OK.
Mercedes.
Thank you. I was wondering if you could say in your view why it is that we're seeing such different numbers in different parts of the UK and to what extent it's down to maybe more effective biosecurity measures, or to what extent it's simply about the density of population of birds, or whether it's that we're maybe, I don't know if this applies like it did with COVID, maybe we're behind the curve and it's coming up here. Or
yeah, we certainly could be behind the curve, and so we're continually monitoring what's happening so that if we need to take further measures, we can. As I said in the previous answer, we have slightly different populations of overwintering waterfowl. We have a less high density of poultry within different areas of Scotland. And actually, the problems that we saw last summer were largely in seabirds, but seabirds don't tend to interact and come inland. Gannets, guillemots, cormorants would normally be coastal birds, and then in the winter they take themselves back out to sea again. Poultry would not tend to access shores, beaches, the Bass Rock, whatever. So there are a whole number of factors there. I don't think it's any one in particular, and it is possible that in the next few weeks the picture here will deteriorate, in which case we will need to take further action.
Thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think we all accept that avian flu doesn't stop at political borders, but you are making some persuasive arguments about why the situation at the moment appears to be a bit different in Scotland and in the rest of the UK, or in England anyway. I wonder, are you in touch with, or how are you, I'm sure you are, but how are you in touch with colleagues in England so that you have a kind of advance picture of what might be coming to Scotland in the future?
Yeah, we have twice weekly CVO meetings, stock takes on a Monday and a Thursday morning as a matter of routine to discuss new outbreaks, to understand what's happening. It's not so much that disease is likely to spread from England to Scotland. Once the wildfowl reach their overwintering grounds, what will make them move is a cold snap, and it's very unlikely that England would be colder than we are, so they tend not to come north again. But one of the things that we're monitoring is weather further north. So if it becomes very cold in Norway or Iceland, that may drive even more birds south to us, and that would increase the risk. But the chances of it spreading northwards from England are slim, not impossible, but that's something that we keep talking about. And that's why I know what's happening in England with the gene sequencing and where they think they've got recrudescence of disease rather than new introductions from wild birds. It's because we communicate well together on a regular basis.
Thank you.
Just before we move on to the next topic, you talked about the disease being worse in turkeys, and yesterday at the Westminster hearing we heard that I think there's about 8 million turkeys in the UK, but about 50% of the free-range turkeys have either died or been slaughtered, about 1 million birds. What's the picture like in Scotland? Do we have a large, well, I suppose it doesn't matter whether it's a large-scale industry, it would certainly be devastating for those involved in it, but do we have many outdoor flocks of turkeys or chickens that might be destined for the Christmas market?
Turkeys, we don't have very many at all. We've got a few tens of thousands. They tend to be seasonal producers, people who keep a few hundred turkeys for the local market within Scotland, unlike the commercial turkey production in England. England have slaughtered 1.67 million turkeys, but in context, they normally would slaughter about, that 1.67 is for disease control. The normal Christmas market is about 10 million, a proportion of which are slaughtered early in the year and frozen. So I'm not, turkey may be scarcer, but I'm not concerned that there isn't going to be any turkey around this Christmas.
Okay, thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for your evidence this morning. It's been really helpful. In my constituency, Banffshire and Buchan Coast, we've had it's been a really bad impact upon the coast, the seabirds in particular. I went to visit Troophead during the summer, and it's just devastating, particularly in regards to their breeding patterns and how this can affect for many years to come the numbers of birds there. And I noted that you did say, you know, it's very unlikely that the coastal birds would be carrying this to poultry farms. But I think because people have been on quite a bit of high alert within the area, we now have a breakout in the area, there is a perception and a fear there with my constituents. And just, you know, asking on their behalf as well, you know, what is the likelihood that this is going to really break out into the poultry farms in the area and cause devastation that they are really concerned about? They're wondering why there is no mandatory housing order here as well. So I wonder if you can just explain a bit about that and try and alleviate some fears.
Yeah, I totally understand that your constituents and most poultry farmers are really, really worried about this. But biosecurity by itself is the single most important thing that people can do. Housing is one of the tools that we have in the box. We have not yet gone down the route of mandatory housing, but that's not to say that we wouldn't. But we need to offset that against the pattern that we're seeing and the evidence that housing itself may be a risk factor because it allows lower doses to take a hold and to spread compared to birds that are outside. Okay. So absolutely it's something that I wouldn't rule out. It will depend on a whole number of factors like migrating patterns, what birds we're seeing, wild birds we're seeing, what the outbreaks are, what the epidemiology is. For example, the outbreaks in the company in your part of the wood have all been in birds that have been housed. Mm-hmm. They were voluntarily housed. They would normally have been free range, but they were brought inside and then got disease a number of weeks later. So the single most important thing that we can do is communicate good biosecurity to those involved. And sometimes it's the little things, things like storing bales of bedding outside where wild birds have access, and then taking them inside and taking the wrappers off, spreading whatever's on the top of them around. So there are things that we can do before we go to housing, but that's not to say housing wouldn't come in.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Well, I mean, the question that I'm being asked to ask you is the basis for the government's decision not to require mandatory housing at this time, but I think it's kind of wrapped up in a whole load of other issues around my curiosity about what is currently in place that you're talking about in terms of biosecurity that has been, is it formalised? Is that a formalised order on in terms of that zoning? Can you talk us through that and why, perhaps back to the original question, you believe that is sufficient in terms of what farmers are doing, considering what Karen Adams just said, and my colleague David Duguid, who's been very concerned about what's happening up in Aberdeenshire, and indeed the wild bird prevalence of bird flu on the Moray Firth as well.
Yeah. So all the administrations across the UK brought in an avian flu prevention zone early in October, which mandated that people must improve biosecurity. And there's some quite good guidance about things that people can and should be doing in order to improve that biosecurity, and importantly, how they can do it. And colleagues within the Animal and Plant Health Agency have been offering advice to different groups who've contacted them. I myself, with Alistair and with APHA, had a meeting with the company that's been badly infected to go through what we had found, to explain where we think the deficits are and what could be improved. So biosecurity is key. There is a risk assessment that was carried out by the European Food Safety Authority a number of years ago, which demonstrates that biosecurity will improve things to a factor of 44. Housing will improve things by a factor of 2. So, and coupled with the fact that you may need less virus in housed birds to cause a problem, housing is the last thing to do. It will give added protection when everything else is right, but it won't in itself solve the problem. There are difficulties with housing. We can require mandatory housing if we believe it will improve the health of the birds, but housing itself causes welfare problems, particularly in smaller and backyard flocks, which are not set up to be kept inside. And so there is always a balance between sheds that are used to having 32, 40,000 birds in them and people who have 20 and have no way of keeping them inside.
Okay, so just to be clear, on the biosecurity measures, are they exactly the same as what they are in England? Right, okay.
Yes.
And do they have steps to them? Do they?
No, it's... biosecurity is an interesting one. Everybody should be practising as good biosecurity as they can all the time, regardless. The prevention zone is a way of mandating and encouraging people to think more carefully about what they're doing. But every case that we've seen, there have been significant lapses in biosecurity.
I've just got one small point.
Very small.
How does the biosecurity work if you've got interaction between wild birds and domestic birds, where you can't stop wild birds?
Normally, you wouldn't have that direct interaction. Most poultry farms don't have geese and ducks on their ranges as a matter of course. If they do, then there is always the option to house voluntarily because they can't keep them off. But part of the biosecurity is having bird scarers or people or dogs or other measures that will keep the wild birds away from the ranges. The ranges are not huge. Even a shed of 32,000 poultry doesn't have a particularly large range, so a dog going round it a couple of times a day should be enough in most areas to keep the wild birds off. Now, obviously, the risk is patchy. If you've got a pond in the middle of your range, and we would strongly advise nobody to have a pond in the middle of the range or fence it off, that may be attractive to wild birds and that will increase the risk. But that's an individual risk for an individual farm. and the individual farmer can take actions to mitigate. The housing order would be for the whole of Scotland, and so there is a balance between number of cases, the epidemiology, what else can be done.
Just, do you have any indication of how many poultry farmers have voluntarily housed, and those who are making a voluntary decision not to at the moment? Any idea on the balance?
I can't tell you exactly, but we believe it's somewhere about 10%.
Are voluntary housed?
Are voluntarily okay. Housing.
Thank you.
But that is an estimate based on talking to the egg marketing inspectors.
Okay, thank you. Mercedes.
Thank you. I had a question about, you said that in some premises where the disease has been identified, it's also been identified that there have been lapses in biosecurity. And so I was wondering what steps are available to the Scottish Government to bring those up to standard, and what support is being offered and how those premises will be supported into improving their biosecurity.
So when we discover a lapse, we will discuss it with the owner, but during avian flu, it's often discovered when it's too late to save that crop of birds. However, information is given for future years and how it can be improved. We've also done communications with the industry generally, and colleagues in APHA and indeed the poultry marketing inspectors who work in my team will also offer advice on biosecurity during routine inspections to try to get people to start thinking more critically rather than just accepting what they've always done.
Thank you.
Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Sheila Vos, for your evidence so far. I think my question was around about the criteria that you decide upon with regard to housing, and I think you've covered that in a lot of your responses just now. I was interested as well about the combined meetings that you have with the chief veterinary officers from across Great Britain, and if you use the same kind of targets or balances or numbers in each of the criteria, if that's consistent across the nations?
It's relatively consistent, but it's not an absolute, because it's not that if you get 12 outbreaks, you will house, or if there's suddenly a cold snap, you will require something different. But we do talk about it, and there's a policy group that we're all members of, including Alistair, Animal Disease Policy Group, which is where policy decisions are discussed across the UK. That doesn't mean we always come to the same policy decision, but it's a place for critical challenge so that if England disagrees with what we're doing, they can challenge, they can put forward an argument. Likewise, if I think that Wales is housed too early, I can challenge them and ask for input. So it's partly about cooperation, but it's also about being a critical friend to each other. It can be quite lonely being being a vet with not too many people that you can talk to. So it is also a sort of support group where we can bounce ideas off each other.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And you talked about migrating birds as well, so coming from Eastern Europe and also from further north, Greenland and Iceland. Again, what connections do you have with our critical friends in Europe as well?
Yep. We continue to monitor the pattern across Europe. There is a group called the International Disease Monitoring Group who do monthly reports, but they also do preliminary outbreak assessments for new things. And that includes avian influenza, but it also scans the horizon for foot and mouth or African swine fever and other diseases. So it gives us early warning of what's happening across Europe. Mm-hmm. And from that, we can look at trade patterns, particularly for other diseases, to see if that puts us at an increased risk. We work with the Met Office to look at weather, long-term wind direction, and we work with an ornithological expert panel to assess wild bird species, what the interactions are likely to be, where they're coming from. and layer that into the information about what species we've seen with disease. So there, it's a bit of a spider's web, which is why I can't say this is the trigger. Mm-hmm. There is an element of we will know. But the other factor is that our wild birds tend to hang around longer in Scotland than elsewhere in GB mm-hmm. or UK. So potentially at the other end of the season, we could want to keep measures in longer. And it's important that we don't penalise our producers unnecessarily, because there is only a finite period during which housed birds can still be marketed as free range.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you very much.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Ed, nice to see you both. It's just a supplementary on what Jenny has just brought up to you there. As someone who clearly remembers the 2000 foot and mouth outbreak and the differentials between the different countries, for me, and I'm asking your opinion on this, that independence of being able to make those decisions on a countrywide basis, i.e. Scotland, England, Northern Ireland, Wales, making their own decisions. I get that there's this cross-border and collaboration and talking all the time, but how important is it to have that independence to be able to make those decisions independently in your own area?
I think it's important because it allows us to fine-tune things to our local situation. Although there is housing across the whole of England, potentially Northumbria and Cumbria could have been excluded from that because the position there is not that different from Scotland. However, we're stuck within jurisdictions that we have, and so being able to look at things with a lens that says what's right for this area means that we can do the best for our producers and our markets and our consumers, to be honest.
So the point I was making on that is exactly what you've just hit the nail on the head. In 2000, we had a national shutdown. Scotland was completely shut down for foot and mouth, and it devastated the industry. And I clearly remember it was living hell. But in 2007, it was a much smaller outbreak, and it could be contained in pockets. That's kind of crucial in making these decisions, so you need to have that independence to be able to make those decisions.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Foot and mouth is very different from avian flu, however.
Yeah,
foot and
I
mouth
that.
Spreads largely by animal movements. And in 2001, when we had the big outbreak, it was animal movements that spread the disease around, and we had pockets of disease in Scotland. In 2007, it was contained to the southeast of England.
Yeah.
But that meant that we were able to put forward a case that Scotland should be treated differently. We were able to remove restrictions more quickly, starting with the islands, moving to the mainland, and we also got back our ability to trade internationally more quickly.
Okay, thank you.
Just on that, the discussions you have with the CVOs from elsewhere, and there is a call from some quarters for the Scottish Government to practice the precautionary principle, and we've heard some of the reasons why that's a balance. What are the views of the CVOs from the other areas? Are they... Do you deal with it in isolation? So you share information, but you make the decisions individually. And a follow-up from that as well, is there an ability to just put in housing orders in certain areas within the England or Scotland? So, for example, could you impose a housing order for the northeast of Scotland and not for Dumfries and Galloway, for example?
So to take the second point first, yes, we can, but in the northeast of Scotland, it's all been housed flocks, which is why we've not triggered. Had these all been free-range flocks that were out on their ranges, the decision may well have been different there.
Okay.
So yes, we can do it differentially, but we still need the evidence to do it. The decision-making comes down to the CVO in the individual country. However, my colleagues are supportive of the decision that we've made. The justification in Northern Ireland was to make the island of Ireland one group. Christine in England was content. They went before everybody else. And she was supportive of the fact that we didn't have the evidence here to justify it. But ultimately, I will advise the Cabinet Secretary And the decision will be made for Scotland on Scottish evidence, having factored in what others are saying.
Yeah, because I guess there's pros and cons to an individual or a UK-wide basis.
Yes, absolutely. In some ways, UK-wide is easier. UK-wide is definitely easier. It avoids criticism. It makes it simple for people to understand what they're doing, but it's not necessarily the right thing to do, because at the other end of the season, we could be in a position where we don't want to lift it, and then only Scottish eggs would have to be marketed as barn rather than across the whole of the UK.
OK, thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. It's been really helpful. I think a few of us on this committee now in yourselves are a bit more familiar with viruses and precautionary measures and such like, and washing our hands and wearing masks and things like that. Yeah. So a bit more understanding than maybe I would have had maybe 2-3 years ago on precautionary measures. But just to ask, you know, what are the effectiveness of these things? How precautionary are they? And how much of that is dependent on communication with the poultry farmers and their ability to be able to carry out these measures?
Yep. The biosecurity gives a factor of 44 in improvements. So rather than having 45 flocks infected, if there was absolutely no biosecurity, pristine biosecurity will take it down to one flock. So that alone is really important. And of course, levels of biosecurity will put the number somewhere in between. Housing, by comparison, will stop one out of two if it's done. So there is a real differential there. I'm sorry, I've forgotten the second part of the question.
It was just how effective is that? It was asking how effective these measures are, but how dependent that effectiveness is on the communication and the carrying out of it.
It is only effective if we can communicate effectively with the industry, because ultimately it's the people on the farms who need to practice the biosecurity, who need to do all the different things. APHA, who deliver for Scotland on the ground, have had some webinars and things for the industry to attend. And we've targeted particular companies. The egg marketing inspectors have been talking about biosecurity when they go out. So we're trying very hard to reach producers. But ultimately, it depends on the producer actually wanting to do it and see the advantage of it, because all the measures will mean that things take a little bit longer than they would if you just walked into a shed from outside in your ordinary wellies without a boiler suit and don't dip your boots.
Now that's really helpful, because I know as the MSP for the area, I want to make sure that that's communicated across as directly as possible, and also be able to signpost to where they can get help and support to be able to carry out these measures.
I wouldn't want anybody to go away thinking I'm blaming the company in your area. There have been biosecurity failings, but actually they were trying to do the right thing as they saw it. So I do think it's important that we don't start slinging blame around. Failings should be a way to help people do it better in the future, not to penalise them.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Alistair Allen.
I think, to be honest, some of the questions I was going to ask have really been covered, but I wonder if you can just briefly say something about the effectiveness of different prevention measures that there are. And I'm not asking you to put them in a scale of effectiveness, but you've mentioned culls, and what are the other options, apart from housing, obviously? Housing.
So culling is the measure that we currently have. There are vaccines being developed. Up until now, we haven't been able to use vaccines because that would have badly impacted on our ability to trade in either poultry or poultry products. Vaccines themselves are not easy. Like human flu vaccinations, the virus changes very quickly, and so repeated vaccination for different strains or different permutations of the same strain would be needed. In birds, it also needs to be two injections at several weeks apart, which makes it expensive. And for a broiler chicken, your average chicken that is slaughtered and is on the table at 5 weeks old, it's just not practical. So there's ongoing work looking at how vaccines can be developed, how they can be administered more easily. The other difficulty with current vaccinations is that they're suppressive, not curative. So again, like COVID, they will reduce the signs that the birds show, and they will reduce the amount of virus that the birds excrete, but they won't stop them, which is why trade becomes impacted, because it's very difficult to differentiate one that has been infected naturally and one that has been vaccinated. So it's on the horizon, but it's not ready to use yet, sadly.
Thank you.
Just we're aware that, you know, if we start using vaccines, the disease status of the whole of the UK and Northern Ireland, it would be affected and absolutely have an impact on exports. This at risk of going off on a tangent, you know, there is a suggestion that given the short lifespan or cycle of a chicken, you know, and I think the longest is about 4 months for food production. What is the opportunity to have gene editing to quickly bring in a strain of chicken that is more resistant to avian flu? Is that something that you've looked at?
The Roslin Institute are looking at susceptibility to flu viruses with the intent of trying to breed a chicken that is more resistant. I would need to check where that research is actually at. I don't think it's in any way close to commercial as yet, but it's something that in the future may be a possibility.
Okay, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks. I'm just picking up on Alistair Allen was asking about different prevention measures, and I'd just be interested to understand from you if anyone has actively looked for HPA1 virus in outflow water from infected poultry premises and in nearby aquatic environments.
Not that I'm aware of. I would need to check. There is a lot of science being done. You're not aware of anybody?
No, but I know that FluMap is potentially looking at some of those environmental factors as part of the wider impact on wild birds. So we can look into that and come
FluMap is a consortium of scientists who are looking particularly at avian influenza. So we can come back to you with that information.
That would be very helpful, thank you. And then I'm just also interested to understand if it's possible that wild birds might contract HPA1 from infected poultry operations or indeed infected released game birds. I understand that the virus is present in pheasants that are raised in France, and then we bring pheasants here to Scotland and release them every year. So that, you know, is it possible that that can be adding to the pressure of the virus in Scotland?
Theoretically, yes. We didn't actually import pheasants from France this year because of the avian flu situation in France. And pheasants are one of the species that are very susceptible to the virus. So generally, by the time they get sick, they're dying very quickly. And so it would be very surprising not to know that there was virus within them. You're not allowed to release pheasants if they're not well. And in the zones surrounding infected premises, equally, you can't release pheasants. So no pheasants should be released that have the virus. But that's not to say that once they're out in the environment, they couldn't succumb to virus that's already in the environment. And then potentially they would multiply it up and could spread it back. But it would be an unusual situation to do that. You also asked about spread from poultry premises to wild birds. The reason that as soon as disease is suspected, birds must be shut inside and are then culled and disposed of by incineration or rendering is to prevent virus getting back out into the environment in substantial quantities. Now, I can't say for certain no virus could escape, but it should be a very small amount. And the general scientific consensus is it would be not significantly adding to what's there in the background anyway.
Thanks for that. And you said with the pheasant releases that you're not allowed to if pheasants are carrying the virus, if they're sick. How is that monitored?
Because it's only monitored by the birds becoming sick and dying because they are so susceptible. There's no routine testing of birds before they're released because if they were carrying the virus, they would be sick and it would be very obvious.
But it's the piece about, you know, you're not allowed, so the person who has the pheasant, how do we track that behaviour, their decision to release the birds or not?
In the same way as a lot of the things that we do potentially could be enforced by local authorities, the actual enforcement relies on people doing the right thing in the same way that we rely on people within zones not moving or applying for a licence or doing the other things. There is some enforcement, but I would be lying if I said we go out and check all of them on a daily basis to make sure they're still in pens.
Thank you.
I think we could be confident in saying that nobody's releasing sick pheasants.
And nobody's releasing pheasants at this time of year either.
No.
They're released in August, early September.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Shall thank you very much for this. This has been hugely helpful, the evidence that you've given today. It's been fantastic. However, you have given me about 10 different questions. I'm probably not going to get through them all. So I'll start off with this. I've got a constituent whose free-range birds are about 6 miles away from Loch Leven, and he is very agitated, understandably, that he has got tens of thousands of geese flying across his flight path, literally on a daily basis, because they'll fly across him to feeding grounds up where I live, and then they'll fly back again at night. What can he do in terms of his own biosecurity in order to protect his flock? And if, because of that circumstance, could he house his birds, but would that cause him to lose his status of free range?
So a couple of questions there. The first one is stop the geese landing on his range. Geese mostly defecate from the ground. So it's birds landing that are the biggest risk, not simply flying over. That's not to say there is no risk from flying over, but it's much less.
Okay.
So stopping them landing, put bird scarers out, use a cartridge gun banger thing, put a dog round the range several times a day. That sort of thing will keep geese away. But there are individual flocks for whom housing may be the right answer. And yes, he is at liberty to house them, but yes, after a few days, he would lose his free range status. That said, the differential in price on the market between barn eggs and free range eggs at the moment is not great. And so it would depend very much on a supermarket contract and what he's tied into, whether there's a cost implication from choosing to house.
Okay, sorry, thank you.
That's okay.
I'm reading my notes as you were.
No, I was trying to think if there was anything else I should have answered.
No, that's ideal. One of the things that did slightly concern me, as an ex-pigeon fancier, we used to send birds to France all the time, and they were vaccinated even when I was a boy to do that flying. Does the vaccine stop racing pigeons carrying virus?
Racing pigeons are generally vaccinated against paramyxovirus, which is a different virus to avian flu. They're not usually vaccinated against avian flu.
Right.
So They can still go to France and race. There was a problem with Brexit about that, in that all lofts had to be registered, but we now have a computer system called the Pigeon Loft, of all things.
Original.
Where, yes. Where people can go on and register, and that allows an appropriate certification to be produced to let them go. If the pigeons were in a zone about 10 kilometres round an infected premises, then they couldn't go, but the rest can.
Right, OK. And one other thing slightly concerned me earlier on, and I was aware of this, but it hadn't really dawned on me. The vast majority of turkey producers here in Scotland are small-scale producers, and they'll buy poults for finishing. Where are those poults coming from?
They will come from hatcheries, particularly in England, but they've been here for long enough that we're comfortable. When a turkey flock goes down, if it's a breeding flock laying eggs that then go on to be hatched, tracings are done from any infective premises, tracings of people, tracings of product, be that meat or eggs or poultry litter or feed lorries. And so eggs for hatching would be traced back to the hatchery. If they were laid at a time when we think the birds might have been infected, they're destroyed. And if not, if the biosecurity within the hatchery is good enough, then they're allowed to move under licence. So okay, we're comfortable that we haven't brought infection up here. And our production is seasonal, so I wouldn't expect turkey eggs or poults to be coming to Scotland probably until about summer of next year.
That's helpful. So I'm going to go back about the implications of imposing housing orders. See, a lot of the stuff that we're hearing just now is a demand to get these birds housed. But what I thought was really telling was your 44 as two, against two. The housing order was the thing that was going to protect the birds. As a livestock keeper myself, biosecurity was always the thing that you had to worry about. I think it's really important that we get that message across, that your personal biosecurity is far more important than the actual housing, given the fact that you've got this factor of 44 as against a factor of 2. Are we getting that message across adequately?
We can always do better. We're trying to get the message across, but some people are just so worried about it, they're not hearing. It's slightly counterintuitive that if you have birds out in a range where there might be wild birds, housing them is not as protective as getting rid of your rodent problem or stopping wild birds flying into your sheds. So we can always do better. We're trying hard to get the message out, and I would welcome any help from anybody who can help to get that message out, because there's always more we can do. We are in regular discussion with Robert Thompson and Penny Middleton and others from NFUS. I speak to the British Poultry Council, the British Egg Industry Council, Scottish Free Range Egg Producers Association, and try to get messages to backyard keepers as well, but they're by far the hardest group to get to, because there is no body that disseminates things to them.
Okay, and my final question is this. If the government imposed a housing order, would that in itself protect the status? Or you, let me clarify my thinking here. If you don't mandate the order to house them, and they choose to house them themselves, they would lose the free range status after a few days. If you mandate them to house them, would they maintain their free-range status?
Yes, that's the key difference.
Right.
If government requires housing, then the free-range status can be protected for 16 weeks, which means that for a laying hen that has a lifespan of usually 60, 70 weeks, that's only a small part. For broiler crops that finish within 4 to 5 weeks, potentially you could have 2 or 3 crops of birds that have never been outside and still marketed as free range.
Yeah,
so again, there's a balance. Housing is not the only answer, but there's a time and a place.
Yeah, but the problem from the government's point of view is that housing is not necessarily the thing that's going to stop the spread of the outbreak.
It's not, yes, that's it exactly. It's not a silver bullet to stop the spread of an outbreak. it's not without concerns about welfare, because birds that have been used to going outside that are suddenly cooped up will do a lot of feather pecking and damage themselves and don't have the same free access. I've forgotten what the third point was, but
I think, we'll
I think that's point. Probably enough.
Yeah, that's probably it. Yeah. Convener, thank you.
Thank you. Just for clarification, if there's a mandatory housing order, you're saying that the free range status wouldn't change, or would?
It would not change for 16 weeks.
Okay, so
4 months.
So there's an extension to what would be if they voluntarily housed?
If they voluntarily house, they can do that for a few days on the advice of their own vet.
Okay.
But they can't house for that prolonged period and keep their status.
Okay, thank you. That's good clarification. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a very short question. When you're balancing up whether or not a housing order is appropriate or not, what weight do you put on the implications that it will have on the producers and ultimately on the supply chain?
Ultimately, I make the decision on disease prevention, because that's what legislation says. If government requires housing to prevent disease, then the status may be maintained. I can't make a decision on anything else, but of course it's at the back of my mind. My heart goes out to producers at the moment. They're having a really horrible time, not just with avian flu, but with cost increases and contracts and things.
Thank you.
Just finally, and I hope you can answer this. I understand there's been an easement of marketing rules in England, and I think there's going to be a derogation that we're going to be dealing with on the 14th of December, which would allow the early slaughter and freezing, or the slaughter and freezing of turkeys or geese or whatever, and they'll be allowed to be defrosted before put on the shelves again. And we're going to look at that. So that's one intervention. When it comes to compensation, at the moment, the compensation rules around birds being slaughtered, there's questions over whether it's satisfactory and whether those payments should be made, whether prior to a cull being carried out or after, you know, to ease cash flows and whatever. And you know, we've also placed a lot of emphasis on biosecurity. Should there be support or emergency support for those businesses that need to put in additional biosecurity to help protect the national flock rather than just individual businesses? Is that something that government should be considering?
That's a really difficult one. Because the disease doesn't spread from one flock to another, just because your neighbour has gone down doesn't put you at significantly increased risk. And ultimately, biosecurity is something that people should be doing for themselves to protect their own birds. Whether those are five birds in the back garden that you think of as pets, or whether that's 500,000 birds, it's in the producer's own gift to do it, but it's to his advantage.
Okay.
The point about freezing, yes, that was an easement that was put in first in England to allow particularly turkey producers to slaughter early and market. The same is happening here for a prescribed period from, I think it's from the 28th of November to the 14th of December. Just to make sure that turkeys are available. It's unlikely to have a major effect here because of the small production that we have. And then compensation. Scotland has always had a different compensation policy to England. And so in Scotland, we pay compensation from the point at which I confirm disease at market value. And the market value is assessed by looking at the price paid for birds over the last couple of months and averaging it. So we're actually in a better position there. By paying from the point of confirmation, that's the point at which the owner has no further control over their flock. But it also incentivises early reporting, because we don't pay for birds that have died before confirmation.
Okay, that's it. We've got three very short supplementaries. We've run out of time. I'm going to go to Mercedes, Rachel, and then Jim Fairley.
So they are on a new topic.
final, very short supplementaries.
Okay. Yes. So they're on climate change. So it's been said that climate change is bringing wildlife in closer proximity to human settlements, and so that increases the likelihood of illnesses such as like COVID-19 among human populations. And I would be interested to hear if there is a similar increased risk with diseases that affect animals, so for instance with avian flu.
So the short answer is yes. Climate change is changing the patterns of particularly migration, and means that we as humans are now coming into either species or of animals that we wouldn't previously, or we have longer contact with others. The particular concern is not avian flu, because it's particularly a disease of the cold and the wet, and climate change is likely to result in the temperature going up. So avian flu is not a good example, but things like West Nile disease, which is spread by midges and mosquitoes, that could find it has a further north range as the climate warms up and habitats become suitable for other species.
And so what are the sort of measures, long-term measures or mitigations that the government's looking at to make us our populations of animals more resilient to climate change?
I should give us a brief of that. It is opening a whole new can of worms, and it's not specifically related to avian flu.
Okay.
If you could just give us a very brief...
Okay. We're monitoring what's going on elsewhere in the world so that we've got early warning. Some of the diseases we can vaccinate against but don't routinely because they're not a problem here. Vaccination could be available, and new vaccines are being developed all the time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If
you thought there was more you could add, I'm sure the committee would welcome your writing to us to highlight some of the main concerns you have.
There's probably not a lot else.
Okay, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
It's just two quick questions. One is on the current biosecurity measures, and you mentioned whether you've got five hens or 500, 5,000, whatever it might be. There are fines with it that lie within that if you don't adhere to them, is that correct? Such as vermin control and others. In terms of the number of people that adhere to this, as you said, it only works, and it's only successful if everybody does that. So is there any way of monitoring that, and how is it... even if there isn't avian flu that's prevalent in a particular region of Scotland, how is that monitored? And secondly, to whom does one report an incident of avian flu? Is that through DEFRA or is that a specific Scottish line?
No, it's a GB helpline that DEFRA administer for the whole of Great Britain.
And you monitor that?
Yes. They record the data and they arrange people to sample, but we get weekly reports from them on how many, where, what's come back positive, and also what's come back negative.
So just quickly, are the numbers of reports higher than the numbers of those that you have found? Is there a large number of reports, people worried about avian flu?
There's a larger number than have come back positive, because the reporting system is set up to advise us about the risk to poultry. So once we know that greylag geese on the Solway are positive, then we won't sample more greylag geese on the Solway for a period of usually a couple of weeks, because we know what the problem is there. So there will always be more reports than are actually sampled. The helpline is very much about sampling and understanding where the disease exists and in what species. It's not about collecting carcasses.
Okay. I'm not going to ask the next question, which you can imagine what I'm going to ask, which is the time lag between the reporting and the thing, but I won't ask that.
Thank you.
It's only a couple of days.
Right.
A couple of days. There we are. Jim Fairley.
Sheila, you've been taken through the mill today. Hats off to you. I did want to come back on one thing. Has egg production in the country been affected by bird flu?
Yes, but not as much as it's been affected by price increases and people choosing not to restock when their egg-laying flock is depopulated. I believe as GB, I don't have the Scottish figures, but as GB, the number of hens on the ground is about 1.7 million down from where it was last year, purely because people have chosen not to because they lose money on egg production. Avian flu, by comparison, has killed maybe a million birds, but a lot of these people are going back into production.
Yeah, so the reports that avian flu is causing the egg shortage are not entirely
correct. They're not wholly accurate. There is an effect from avian flu, but it's not the primary problem. It's a contributing factor.
The primary problem is price to producer.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. And it's a yes or a no question, really. What role do local authorities have as public health bodies? Do they have a role in inspecting, or where does that role fall?
Yes, they do. The response to avian flu is very much a partnership between lots of different bodies, and the local authorities are the enforcement agency. But when there's an outbreak, they also help with foot patrols, because one of the things I didn't say is that around an infected premises, we will do foot patrols to find out what other poultry are there and to make sure it's healthy. And that's one of the roles that local authorities take on, but enforcement is their main role.
OK. Do you have any concerns about the capacity within local authorities to carry out those requirements?
Our experience is that local authorities are prioritising it, but they're always telling us that resources are stretched and they're having to do that at the extent of something else.
OK, thank you. Sheila, you mentioned that you might have issues, or there could be potential issues getting the message out there. I would suggest, given the considerable interest there is in avian flu, your contributions today will have assisted in getting the message out there. So thank you very much for your detailed and fascinating contribution today. We all appreciate it. I'm sure the wider community will also appreciate your contribution today. So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you all.
We'll now suspend for a short comfort break, and we come back beg your pardon. We're going to deal with the UK subordinate legislation now. My apologies. We have consideration of consent notification relating to UKSI, the Plant Health Amendment EU Exit Regulations 2022. Do any members have any comments on the notification? No. Are members content with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out in the notifications being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Content. Okay, that concludes our business in public, and we'll now move into private session. We will reconvene in 10 minutes.